Hi, once again, I'm Alan Irwin from Santa Barbara Infrared, and in this video, we're going to be discussing noise, and we'll also talk about three different tests that are used for measuring noise. So, right off the bat, what is noise? Well, noise is the variation in signal that we measure that is not due to what's in the scene. In other words, it's all the stuff that's not what we're looking at. So, why do we care about noise? Well, noise limits the smallest temperature that we can measure. Anything that's got a smaller temperature variation than the noise just disappears in the noise. So let's take a look at what that can be like. Here we have a very small step, but it's an important step in the background we're trying to see. Here we have the noise that's in the environment due to lots of different sources, but there's the noise. And when we superimpose those two, well, could you see there was a step there? If I know there's a step, I probably could have said, yeah, there it is. But if I didn't even know what was there, I don't think I would have ever picked that signal out. So the noise limits what we can see. Now, there are a lot of sources of noise. There's the electronics noise, there's the size of the sensor, because sensors aren't infinitely small, so you have some step variation. There's the fact you're digitizing the signal, so there's step variation there. Optics don't always pass light perfectly. You can have variation for lots of different reasons, and all those are various sources of noise. I'm not so concerned about all the sources as I am about the impact on the output of the camera. This is a system-level test. What's our smallest temperature that we can measure? So we measure noise to understand the limits of what our camera can do, but also in some cases so we can take corrective actions. There are ways we can deal with certain types of noise. Now, the way we measure noise, several different ways that we'll take a look at a noise on a camera. One, we could look at an overall measurement. We can see a single value come out of that noise, and that's what we report, is a single NETD measurement. Or we can look at the output from every pixel in a camera, and we can measure the noise on each pixel individually, so we have a population of noise. And here in the second graph, what we can see is that along the horizontal axis, there's the noise, and the vertical axis is the number of sensors that have that noise. And that population lets us see how consistent the output of our sensors are. The third way we can look at noise is axial dependency. That means that I can look at the noise that's just in the horizontal or vertical or just over time, and I can start breaking the noise down in those three important axes, and I can also take cross products of those. So by looking at all these different axial dependent noise components, we can sometimes determine sources of noise that allow us to take various corrective actions. Why do we have these different types of tests? Well, there are trade-offs. Some tests take more time, some tests require additional computing resources, and then there's the intended results. What are you going to do with those results that kind of determine the type of test that you're going to measure, or the type of test you're going to perform? Most of our calculations of noise are going to look at a standard deviation. What that means is we're going to take a series of measurements, and then we're going to look at the variability among those measurements. And so this formula is our standard way of making a standard deviation calculation from that set of values. The output unit is going to be the same as the input measurement. So if we're taking all of our measurements in volts, the output of noise is going to be in volts. If we're going to be making all of our measurements with an A to D converter and a frame grabber, then all of our noise measurements are going to be A to D converter counts in terms of the final noise. That's noise. We have a way, though, of normalizing these measurements. If you remember on our previous video, we talked about SiTF. And SiTF is measuring the amount of signal variation due to the amount of temperature variation. If we take our noise and we divide it by the SiTF, we produce a noise signal in units of temperature. And we call that the noise equivalent temperature difference, or NETD. Now, there are variations on that name you'll see. Some people call it NEDT, noise equivalent differential temperature. Some people leave off the D altogether and just call it the NET measurement. They all refer, though, to this normalized value where we've taken the noise of the system and we've converted it in temperature. And we do that because now we can actually compare cameras from different manufacturers. This is the first figure of merit that we can use for comparing different cameras. There are some limits on that, but it becomes this universal measurement for determining the quality or the applicability of a camera to a particular project. One other thing we need to talk about noise, and that's two different broad categories of noise that, again, determine if we can address the noise or deal with the noise. That is to divide our noise up into what's called fixed pattern noise or high frequency noise. Now, this first slide that shows fixed pattern noise, you can see that there's variation on the output. Again, the input to this was uniform, flat, constant temperature. But the output, what we're looking from the camera, is a variation that's very consistent depending on its location. In other words, it doesn't vary with time. It's a fixed pattern over time. This other type of noise, the high frequency noise, may not be quite as obvious. What we're looking at here is the variability that goes on very quickly, and it may be high frequency not in terms of time, although it could be, but also in terms of the size, so that it's happening so quickly in terms of size, or so close to each other, that we can't easily differentiate it as a broad pattern. This high frequency noise is sometimes referred to as the absolute noise, because we can correct for other types, and this high frequency noise is very difficult to correct for. We are going to be talking about three types of tests in this video: spatial NETD, temporal NETD, and the more modern method, which is referred to as 3D noise. And we'll get to that in a moment. All three use the same kind of equipment. We need a calibrated temperature source, which is typically a blackbody, as we've discussed before. We know exactly the temperature that's being presented. Modern blackbodies should be able to easily be controlled within a millikelvin, 1/1000th of a degree. And most can really nowadays get down to below a millikelvin. The Santa Barbara infrared blackbody we refer to as being 1/10th of a millikelvin accuracy. Our format is going to be similar to what we do with SiTF. We can either have a flood format, where we put a blackbody right up against the camera and we stimulate the camera overall, and we are taking our measurements from that. Or we can use a target projection system, as in the second layout, and that involves more equipment, but it's used for lots of different types of testing, so it's a very common configuration used in laboratories for measuring noise. So, what we generally do for a noise measurement is present a constant temperature, and this is what it would look like. You can see the circular aperture we're looking down, in this case, through a target projection system, and we have a uniform source of temperature. And when we set up a test, we usually set up things like, what's the temperature I'm going to be taking my measurements at? What region am I going to be taking my measurements within? So this is a typical setup, especially in IR windows, for doing these sorts of tests. Spatial NETD, what we do is we take a single image, and an area within that image. We take measurements, a single image, and so we look at the measurements of all the pixels within that region, and we do our standard deviation calculation on that population. We don't look at individual pixels, we're looking at an overall overall area, and we produce a final number for noise, divide by SiTF to get our NETD value, and that's our single product. It's called the spatial NETD because we're concerned about spatial variations, the variation of the signal across the whole picture that we're looking at. The next way that we can take measurements is with temporal NETD. And the procedure for temporal NETD says that I'm going to be taking a series of images. So what we're going to say is, how many images am I going to collect? Again, the temperature and the region of interest, very similar to before. But because we're taking the series of images, we need to store all of that. And the reason we take that series of images, and here you can see the data cube, that's the series of images that are collected, so we have both horizontal, vertical, and over time data. We can take any individual pixel and look at how it varies with time. So when we take our temporal measurements, we have a value for every pixel in our field of view, and because we have a whole population of these values, we can produce a histogram. And this histogram lets us make an analysis, and as you can see in this histogram, there's not one peak in sort of a nice Gaussian curve. What we see are these two peaks, which tells me that there are two types of noise groupings, which indicates to me there's some non-balanced component going on in the camera. So you can see that when we have a temporal measurement, I can easily, or more easily, determine problems within the camera. It gives me more information from which I can deduce problems within the camera itself. Now, the third way that we can take a measurement is what's called 3D noise. Now, with 3D noise, we again collect a data cube. We take a series of images so that I have a horizontal, a vertical, and a time axis available to me in this data. There are a specific set of calculations that are applied. Here are the calculations. I'm not going to walk through them in the video. You can take the time looking at them if you want. But these were very well specified, and we follow these specifications. It was the Night Vision Lab, NVL, that specified them. And we walk through those series of calculations, and what it produces are these seven values, this table of values that give me the noise, which I can convert to an NETD value. Those specific values tell me the noise along individual axes. Do I have noise along the horizontal, noise along the vertical, noise over time? And by breaking those down, I have some sense of what the noise source is. If I'm seeing a horizontally based noise, that may be because I have an imbalance in my electronics that drive the output of the sensors. Or it could be that I have a problem in my column electronics, or if I'm seeing variations over time, that could be because I've got a leak coming in from the power source. There are lots of these sorts of things that allow me to isolate where my noise is. I look for large, unusual values in this set. Cross values allow me to look for things that are actually dependent on each other. For instance, if I've got a slewing bar, a bar that's going across the image over time, that gets balanced out so it doesn't show up in the horizontal or the temporal. But if I do a cross product of horizontal and temporal, then that will peak on that kind of measurement. So these axes allow us to see more information about the camera. You have to spend a little bit of time understanding what the different axes mean and how noise can get through. You'll also notice there's a TVH value in there. And that value is non-correlated noise. It's the noise that is not dependent on anything else. It's often referred to as the smallest value. Often that is the one that gets produced because it's the smallest value. So you'll see it in literature when we're talking about a camera and what its capability is. You'll see a single noise value listed. It's the best noise they can possibly get. And the TVH noise, the uncorrelated noise, sometimes called the uncorrectable noise, that's what they'll produce for the camera in terms of published values. So, what do we use noise measurements for? As we talked about, we use it to determine the limits of what the camera can see. We can compare performance between cameras with this. We can look at cameras from the same production line so that we can see whether the camera is working properly within that production line. We can make calibration measurements or calibration correction factors based on making sure that all cameras at least have the same noise value when it goes out. It allows us to compare different models within a single manufacturer, but it also allows us to compare different cameras from different manufacturers so that we can see whether the camera is appropriate for the job that we're after. Not all cameras, just having the smallest NETD value is not necessarily the most important thing in what a camera can do. Sometimes you want to have a camera that can see a very broad temperature range. You don't really care about the noise. But once you know the criteria of what the job of the camera is, you can know what limits that are going to be on the noise, and you can pick out a camera based on a whole range of cameras that produce or publish their NETD values. So you can also use some of the more advanced tests to determine the source of the noise and take corrective action. And this data overall allows us to calibrate measurements and look at calibrating cameras so that we understand the noise, and if we know the source of the noise, remove it with some calibration factor. And that's a good overview of noise.